you're ready.
All right. What's up, fellas?
What's up?
All right, so let's pray. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, Lord. We just thank you for this time that we get to hang out and dig into your word, Father. I just pray now as we do this that you'll just let your word come from me to these fellows, and that all of us, God, will leave here having learned something from this. Your word doesn't turn void, and we can bank on that. I kind of laugh. You let a donkey talk, and people understood. Here I am. So we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So before I start this week, and I've told a couple people, this week has been one of the worst weeks I've had in a long time for a variety of reasons. We won't get into details. But I've been looking at this chapter forever because I knew that it was coming for a while. And I started, and I put it off, and then when I started again, I got redirected several times and then started over several times. I've given it a title, which I'm like, titles are for pastors. I don't title my teaching. But now I have two titles because I traded one and I have another. I don't know which one I should be using. So anyway, it's been an interesting week. And kind of a cool thing, when I came in here, I was feeling a little like, eh. And then I'm talking to you guys, I already feel better, which is part of what this is all about, you know, coming and hanging out, coming to church and everything. So that's a cool thing. The second thing is, you know, when pastors and teachers stand up, they say, hey, this is a good word for you, blah, 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 and it's a word for me. And I'm like, yeah, sure, it's a word for you. Let me assure you, this week and leaving here is going to continue to be a word for me. So anyway, I'm having a Jonah week, let's say. So let's hop into this. So my first title, and I mentioned it to Steve, and this was, I think, like maybe a week and a half or so ago, it was going to be You Can Run, But You Can't Hide. And about 4 days ago, it's been changed to The Long Arm of the Lord. So what I'm going to do first is quickly recap what happened last week in chapter 1, and then we'll pick up here today in verse 17 of chapter 1. So as you remember, we talked about Jonah in the first chapter, and he made the decision that he was going to try and run from God's calling. He decided to run in the complete opposite direction. He was going to go to Nineveh. He was supposed to go to Nineveh, and he said that he headed to Tarshish. It reminded me of the thought that if we're not following God, and if you're not moving toward him, you're not standing pat. You're not staying where you think you are. You're drifting. It's kind of like a boat, right? You row, 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 and it's like, cool, we're here. We're not going to paddle anymore. Next thing you know, you're a mile and a half down the way. And I don't know if I said it in here, but I had an experience once where down in Florida, we had a trolling motor. We used to go out and fish for a small shark and different things like that in the Keys. Well, we lost the trolling motor. We thought we were good, but it blew us about 2.5 miles down. And horrible mosquitoes, and we couldn't row against the tide and the wind, so we tried to catch shrimp with our hands in the mangrove. That's what we did for the evening. So all to say, you might think you're staying where you're at with God, but if you're not moving toward him, I can assure you, you're drifting. So ultimately, we left Jonah at sea. He's been doggy paddling for a week now, because he was tossed into the waves of a mighty storm. So let's pick up now in verse 17 and begin our study, because Jonah's tired. He's ready for something to happen. Verse 17, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. The Hebrew term here for fish is dag, which means a sea creature. There's speculation it was some type of shark, perhaps a whale shark, perhaps a whale. But if it's talking about a sea creature, who knows, right? I read one thing that it's Leviathan. I don't know. It says great fish. All we know is it was pretty large because it was able to swallow Jonah whole. So, pretty big fish. The interesting thing, too, is in this verse it says the fish was prepared. So this isn't just circumstance. It's God orchestrating what's about to occur in chapter 2. In his vast sea, we have a specific place where Jonah's going to be tossed. We have a fish being assigned to go to this appointed place at this specific time to minister to Jonah. I think we could agree it would not be a difficult thing for God to prepare this great fish for his submarine-like task. That will pop in chapter 2. Verse 1. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly. Jonah prayed. Do you wonder or have a mental image of God standing there saying, just pray, just pray. You know you can do it. And finally, you probably see him finally saying, yay! And then actually wondering, you know, why it took so long and why it seems like it was so hard for us to pray. The Lord says, call on me, call on his name, and he can be found. And in all this, right, if he's in the belly of a fish, I think we can say Jonah's kind of hit a rock bottom here. And so as Jonah's praying to the belly of the fish, he's praying to the only one that can help him. And frankly, given where he's at, he's praying to the only one that can actually hear him. Sadly for us, we too need to hit rock bottom before we realize it may be a good time to pray. And I use may in quotes, it's always a good time to pray. So sure, he's still in the fish's belly, but his prayer indicates he is back in communion with God, and therefore, he has hope. He is starting to get it, and he's returning to the Lord his God. Jonah had put himself in harm's way because of disobedience. He had created his own bad circumstances. Sometimes we see punishment, circumstances, or a timeout, if you will, and that could be it could be God's pursuit of us. But a key point here to remember is, not all trials in apparent poor circumstances are God's punishment. It may be God protecting us from something, even in the midst of something ugly, there could be something even more ugly. And then sometimes God wants us to teach us something special, take us a little bit deeper, and sometimes the best way to do that is when we're hurting, when we're going through something that, frankly, we can't handle ourselves, that we can handle with ourselves. Some would say, well, why do I need God? So he can put us in a situation where, guess what? Hello, we need you. Because we can't get out of ourselves. Suffice it to say, God will chase, challenge, and even punish us or correct us out of love. Just like, you know, if you're a parent, what'd you do with your children? You didn't let them do what they wanted, it just that wasn't in their best interest. The good news and bad news of this is we get a choice in what we're going to do. We're going to go to God, or we not. If we're in a bad situation, are we going to go grow better in that situation, or are we going to learn and get better from that situation? The choice is up to us. And what will you do? You're going to walk away during those hard times. Well, will you choose to learn and trust? God ultimately wants for us what is good. Jeremiah 24, 5, and 6. God gave Jeremiah a dream about Israel. This is what he says. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, like these good figs, I will acknowledge those who are carried away captive from Judah, whom I have sent out of the place for their own good, in the land of the Chaldeans. For I will set my eyes on them for good, and I will bring them back to this land. I will build them and not pull them down, and I will plant them and not pluck them up. Key here is, it's for our own good. God knows what's best. You might think we do. We don't. We don't get it sometimes. And then again, in Genesis 50, verse 20, this is Joseph talking to his brothers. But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring about, as it is this day, to save many people alive. You guys remember the story? They sold Joseph into slavery. He's in Egypt, becomes a big wig. Egypt. There's a famine, and next thing you know, his brothers are having to come visit him because they need sustenance. I think God has worked that out for everybody's good. Verse 2. And this to get back to Jonah. He said, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. So God hears us in storms. Jonah knows through faith he will be heard. Because this is true, we too can have peace even before we see an answer. God's going to hear us. It is clear that Jonah, though disobedient, was a man of God. And ultimately he came back to God through his prayers. As we'll see in the reading of chapter 2, this chapter is littered with he's pulling stuff from Psalms, he's pulling stuff from Lamentations, he's pulling stuff from, he's just pulling stuff all over the place in his scripture and his prayer. He's actually praying God's word. Psalm 18:6, this is David, and this is one of those places where Jonah is pulling from scripture. David is referring to something as distress, where Jonah is talking affliction. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried out to my God. He heard my voice from his temple, and my cry came before him, even unto his ears. And then again, Psalm 120, verse 1, again, David. In my distress, I cried to the Lord, and he heard me. David had been in distress because of lies, deceit, false friendships by people he thought were close to him, actually wanting to do him harm. And then Lamentations 3:55, I called on your name, O Lord, from the lowest pit, and he answered me. So we hear Jonah talking about being in a pit. Here in Lamentations, we hear and see that this verse 2 is saying, from the lowest pit, I know you're going to answer me. And Jeremiah felt that he was under attack from his enemies, and he was overwhelmed, and he was mentioning being silenced in a pit. Ultimately, hardships can help us bend a knee to God and the prayer, if we allow ourselves to go there, can start a personal revival. And I was thinking about this. If it's a personal revival for him, what's actually happening right there in the belly of this fish is the revival of Nineveh actually begins. If Jonah doesn't pray, doesn't confess, doesn't change his ways, doesn't go to Nineveh, sure, God may send somebody else, but he had a plan to use Jonah. But who knows how that plays out, right? But he had picked Jonah for this. So by virtue of Jonah changing his ways, he was going to get to go to Nineveh and be a mouthpiece of God for repentance for Nineveh as well. And like I said before, trials, tribulations, afflictions can be a way for us to see God and need God like no other ways. And ultimately through that, it's a way that we can see that we have really no control, nor do we have ultimately much authority in what's going on either. So Jonah cried out to God and God heard. And Jesus reading the same thing, right? Remember Matthew 8:24-26, this is with the disciples. And suddenly, verse 24, and suddenly a great tempest arose out upon the sea, so that the boat was covered with waves, but he was asleep. Then his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we are perishing. But he said to them, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. So your first thought would be, Jesus is right there. Why are you scared? Right? Alright. But then on the other hand, sometimes you get scared. I know I have Jesus. I know he's right there with me. But guess what? Human nature kicks in and you're like, you know what? I'm scared. So on some level, who cares? Cry out to God so he can save you. This is exactly what Jonah is. Then in 1 John 5:15, if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have petitioned, that we have asked of him. So by these examples and a lot more in scripture, we can know that if we call on you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. So Jonah is seeing God's hand at work in the midst of his self-inflicted trial and circumstance. You know, by his words, we know he's realizing God's authority and control, because he says, "You cast to me in your billow, and you were the one that cast me." The sailors actually had done it, but he's not looking at the sailors saying they did it. He knows they were the hand of God. God ultimately had him cast into the ocean, knowing that the fish was coming. So, do you think he's comforted right now, knowing that he's in God's hands? He's realizing he's in God's hands? I'm thinking probably so. This is something, too, that we can remember. And this was what I was getting to. For me, this week being an interesting week. When you're thinking you're drowning sometimes by circumstance, by things, they may be little things, you know, to some people. You know how it is. Sometimes you have, if you said, "Hey, I've got a hangnail," and it's really, really painful for you, somebody like, "Yeah, it's a hangnail. I've got such and such." But to you, the hangnail is a problem. So, point is, regardless of what your circumstances are, God cares. And cry out, and he can help you. And then, lastly on this verse, we know that Jonah was running, but he couldn't escape the long arm of the Lord. Verse 4, "Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple." So what have we always heard about sin? Adam and Eve had it, right? You sin, it breaks fellowship. So I'm thinking, when it's talking about being cast out of your sight, I'm thinking that Jonah's realizing, I'm not having too good a fellowship anymore. I can't even see God. Psalm 31:22 says, "For I said in my haste, I am cut off from before you. Nevertheless, you heard my voice." So even if we are cut off or feel like we're cut off, all we got to do is go back, repent, and we're right back in fellowship and in communication with God. Jeremiah 7:15 says, "I will cast you out of my sight as I have cast out all your brethren, the whole posterity." Sometimes God just got to discard us for a little bit to let us learn a few things, so we'll come back and look for him at all, or even look for him in a new way. Because what's he wanting all the time? He wants us to grow stronger in our relationship with him. And I think, too, in here, this says, yet it says, "I will look again toward your holy temple." Given the scripture that's used and the demeanor that we hear Jonah speaking with and things like that, and again using the term again, I think at one point he had fellowship, which is why he was missing it, and he's saying, "I'm looking again toward your holy temple," because he knows that's what he needs to be doing. Verse 5, "The water surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head." So do you think Jonah right now is realizing that things aren't good? Having seaweed wrapped around your head in the belly of a fish, probably not a great place to be. In Psalm 69:1, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck." In Lamentations again, "The waters flowed over my head. I said, I am cut off." So Jonah is in a bad place. I remember once when I was a little guy, there was a cartoon on Jonah. And I don't think it was biblically accurate. And we'll get into this in verse 6, whether Jonah was dead or alive in the belly of the fish. Regardless, the cartoon that I saw had Jonah in the belly of the fish with a fire. He was doing marshmallows. He had hot dogs. He was basically having a picnic or a camp out. I don't really think that's the case.
The reality here is Jonah is blind and couldn't see. But even in the midst of this blindness that he had, God was using the fish, and I probably guess Jonah knew what was going on. He just knows he's in the belly of the fish, but guess what direction the fish was going? He was headed back where he needed to be, or where Jonah needed to be. Verse 6, I went down to the brink of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed behind me forever, yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. So I talked to Steve about this a little bit, and this is the first opportunity I've had teaching to talk about something that, for lack of terms, is controversial. Was he dead? Was he alive? In this verse 6 and then even verse 7 is where scholars start to beat each other up, saying, no, it's this way, no, it's that way. So I looked at what the scholar said. I looked at scripture. I talked to a couple people. And this is what I think scripture says. So in King James, if you look at it, we see corruption mentioned here, pit in this version. In King James, it's corruption. Corruption oftentimes is mentioned with death, because when we die, our body gets corrupted. It just goes to dust. And then in Matthew 12, 39 and 40, and then in Luke 11, 29 and 30, Jesus says in these verses the following. But he answered and said to them, an evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be there, be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. And then in Luke 11, verse 29, and while the crowds were thickly gathered together, he began to say, this is an evil generation, it seeks a sign, and no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah the prophet. For as Jonah became a sign to the Ninevites, so also the Son of Man will be to this generation. So, regardless of how you feel specifically about Jonah being alive or dead, if Jesus is talking about it, I think we can say that the story, because a lot of people say, that story isn't even true. Jesus is talking about it. At the very least, I think we can say he believed in the literal story of Jonah. And for me, hopefully for you, if Jesus, if something is good enough for Jesus and Jesus believes it, I think it's probably good enough for us. Hopefully I can go on out on a limb and say that on behalf of all you guys. Again, these verses, particularly verse 40 in Matthew, would seem to indicate that Jonah was dead for 3 days and was resurrected as a true type of Christ. If it were not the case, then he could not be a true sign of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that was part of the point to begin with. Notice, too, that we see nothing in this chapter, or frankly anywhere, to say Jonah was alive in the belly of the fish. So Jonah is said to be a sign to the Ninevites, like the Son of Man would be to his generation. And then there's the use of the words for as and so shall. These terms equate one to other in like fashion. They're representative equal, for lack of terms. So did he die, or did he just hang out for 3 days? At the end of the day, I think we can disagree on this point and still get along. But again, I think the scripturally more accurate position would be that Jesus, or that Jonah, died and was resurrected. If you go out there and Google, there are a bunch of stories about people, and my first thought is, okay, maybe he was, and there was some graphic, okay, people were bleached white, and they had no hair, and this kind of thing, and my first thought would be, and granted, even if he was dead, he may have done all those things, but I just imagine him running back to go see Nineveh, and him being a scientist because he goes white. I thought that would be kind of cool. time to the fish, sure. But again, and then in verse 17, it may be that he died there, and in verse 1, when he started his prayer, that that's when some say, when in verse 1, is when he was resurrected, that's when he starts to pray. And that his body was in the belly of the fish while the soul was in hell. And his resurrection here is in the chapter in verses 1 and 2. Psalm 16:10, just on corruption and specifically Jesus, David has a prophetic word about Jesus in verse 10. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. So hopefully I didn't butcher that too much. Nobody's confused. I'll ask some scholars later how I did. I'm looking right at one. Anyway, verse 7. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered, and I was just for the record, for what it's worth, and I'm trusting that what I asked, what I picked up, what I learned, put me in a place where I was correct from God's position, because that's where I want to be. But do know that standing up here, and you know, I've heard pastors say it a lot, you know, when you're up there teaching, you better make sure you're on point. So I spent a lot of time, even though it may have sounded like I didn't, I spent a lot of time on that, because I do take it seriously. So when my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you, into your holy temple. So when I read this verse, one of the first things that kind of jumped at me was, what about the story of the prodigal son? Remember, this is almost like the V8 moment. Jonah is saying, I remember the Lord. I kind of have the same thing when I think of the prodigal popping himself in the head, saying, I could have had a V8, you know, when he comes to his senses. And he's like, I know I can go back to my dad, because my father's house is probably my best option. Jonah's saying the same thing. Hold it a minute. I remember the Lord. He's my best option. He's always our best option. So sometimes we see and remember God best at the end of our own personal growth. And by virtue of Jonah saying my soul fainted, I think it's clear probably at the end of this growth. Turning to God was his best option. But I would argue maybe it's only his real option. Sometimes we are left, all we are left with is God, and that's not a bad thing. Sometimes we get stripped down to nothing, and we don't have any friends, we don't have this, we don't have that, but if you've got God, you've got something to rely on and something to start with. And then, thinking of all that, reading and thinking, we should have a heart like David in all of this, right? When he's in Psalm 27:4, he says, one thing I have desired of the Lord that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, behold the beauty of the Lord, and inquire of his temple. You know, this is what Jonah's saying. He's going to go back and pray, and he wants to get back to God's temple. Good point to make here is this. Never mistake God's patience and his long-suffering for lack of caring. Know God will do whatever it takes to get your attention. For Jonah, it was having him tossed out of a boat, being put in the belly of a whale for a while. For each of us, it may be something else at any given time. And heck, it could be something small, right? Something small for me, maybe large for you, or vice versa. At the end of the day, God knows the right buttons to push when he needs to push them. And I've used this before. Take the easy button. take the easy button. So it's less painful. So, but again, the you know, all comedy aside, God will do what it takes to get your attention. So he wants a relationship, and he'll take you. So to that end, sometimes God's required to take us to our end of our strength, our ability, our understanding, etc. Psalm 18:6, in my distress, I called upon the name of the Lord and cried out to my God. He heard my voice from his temple, and my cry came before him, even to his ears. Again, another verse saying, you call, I'm here, I got you. Jonah knew where he was to direct his prayers. Verse 8, those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. Forsaking the mercy here means those who worship idols forsake the mercy God would extend by virtue of their sin. So you want idols? You're forsaking mercy. You want to do it your way? You want sin? You can't have, it's going to be hard to have both. So, serve God or man. Jonah resisting God and running is like being an idolater. He was operating on his own agenda. He was his own boss. He was his own idol, for lack of terms. He wasn't submitting to God and to God's will and authority. Ultimately, if we resist God, we are embracing something else. Even if that thing you're embracing is a good thing. Right? If you're holding on tighter to that thing, and I'm looking at several of us that are married, right? Well, I can't look at myself, but several of you guys that are married, if you love your wife more than God, you got a problem. And I know you guys know that. So just think to yourself, what are you approaching God as strong as you approach everything else? You need to be looking to God and reaching for him. So, Jonah wants mercy, but in order to get mercy, we're going to have to confess our sins, and they're going to need to be put away. You choose idols and sin over mercy, or you choose mercy and forgiveness over sin and idols. The choice of repentance and accepting forgiveness The choice of repentance and accepting the forgiveness offered is yours. Proverbs 28:13. Solomon has given us some wisdom here. Who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I think we could say that the cleansing mentioned there is indeed God's mercy. Verse 9, but I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I vow. Salvation is of the Lord. Ah, the sweet sound of thanksgiving. So he's starting to get it, right? Jonah had run in the first place because I think he had disagreed with God and taking a message of salvation and repentance to Nineveh. Why? He didn't think Nineveh deserved God's mercy. He felt Nineveh needed to be punished. How often do we want judgment and punishment for others and mercy for ourselves? Give me mercy. I need mercy. But that person, no, they need judgment. They need something else. It reminded me of Matthew 7:1-5. And this came from our school of discipleship class too. Because I'm thinking Jonah here, right? What did he actually do? He's saying, I'm not going to go offer God's mercy, God's forgiveness as an opportunity. He decided that he was going to kind of judge them. They don't deserve it. He became a judge. And Matthew 7:1-5 says, judge not, be not judged. I think we can say Jonah got judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or, how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your own eye, and look, the plank is in your own eye. Hypocrite. First remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So I think what we see here is Jonah is having a plank removed from his eye. He's having it washed out, if you will, by water in the belly of the fish, so he could go offer God's mercy to the Ninevites. Jonah had decided to judge Nineveh, kind of on God's behalf, by not extending to Nineveh the good news. We truly saw people as God sees people. I think our attitude towards them would change and would be different. I don't think that Jonah looked at the Ninevites thinking they were worthy of forgiveness, or maybe he thought they wouldn't take it, so why bother? Maybe he just thought, God hammered him for a little bit, that would be the answer. And maybe sometimes that's going to be the answer, but in this instance, God said, no, I want you to go talk to them. The hammer wasn't coming down yet. The hammer would come to Nineveh some 90 or 100 years later, I think, something like that. So ultimately, Jonah needed this trial so he would see exactly the way that God saw the situation. He needed to repent. He needed his relationship with God restored. Now Jonah is seeing it and seeing his mission as God sees it. And Jonah is now ready to do the task God has given him. Jonah is now with the program, God's program. And then he says he'll pay what he vowed. The restoration here is indicated by worshiping God with a voice of thanksgiving. And Jonah admits that salvation is of the Lord. I think this is both a final understanding and declaration on Jonah's part. God has got a grace. God has got a love, patience, second chances, and salvation. Jonah is completely understanding and learning what it is he's supposed to learn here. So he extended these things to Jonah, and then Jonah ultimately would be extending these same things on God's behalf to the Ninevites. And once, kind of clear, not that the Lord needed to see if it was clear, because he knew it would be clear, but as Jonah's finally get his vision back, if you will, we'll see here in verse 10 that God is going to speak to this fish on Jonah's behalf. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it was vomited Jonah out onto dry land. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and the first thing that I got to chuckle on is right now there's a new movie coming out called Aquaman. Here's Aquaman. So God spoke to the fish. So it's kind of cool. The Lord has command over the fish throughout this ordeal, and was now directing the fish to deliver Jonah to the shore. God's in control. God's got it under control. He controls man, he controls beasts, he controls weather. He's got it. He doesn't really need our help. He chooses to use us. He chose to use a fish here. God is sovereign, right? He's in control. Daniel 4:35, remember good old Nebuchadnezzar, pretty well-to-do, pretty much ran the world for a little while. For a while he had become a beast because he thought he was all that. The Lord had to show him, no, you're really not. But in this verse 35, he said, all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? So you have one of the most powerful people, probably the most powerful person on the planet, realizing, I'm not all that. God's in control. And this gets back to the thoughts and the stories that you read about people that supposedly were swallowed by whales and things. So I'm having this mental picture again of Jonah being bleached
covered in yuck, hitting the ground, and he's sprinting to where he needs to be. Because he gets it. Are we sprinting like that? Just like Nineveh, our world is desperate for the good news as well. Are we unwilling for some reason to share God, as was the case initially with Jonah? Are we answering our call? The Great Commission, right? You guys have all heard this. You've been in church for more than a year. Heck, maybe even less than that. Mark 16:15, it says, and he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I think Nineveh or Jonah would be all the world. Also remember, too, faithfulness, right, does not mean you will be successful. Jonah, when he went there, there was a great revival, and he was actually very successful. The Lord chose to have that event be successful through Jonah. But the good news for us is this. We are judged on, not judged on our success. As God alone is responsible for the increase, right? 1 Corinthians 3, verse 7. So, then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Rather, we are told by God to be faithful servants. I think that is something that we can do. 1 Corinthians 4, 2. Moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful. Are you faithful? This story is an interesting one and reminds us how God can bring us to a place where he wants us. Jonah saw his deliverance only after his repentance was complete. Was he just sorry for his disobedience? I don't think so. He was learning, or was leaving the experience with a new desire to trust and follow God. This gets back to the idea of are you better or are you bitter? I think Jonah leaving this was a better person. That's what it's about, becoming more Christ-like, right? He's now saying, okay, I do realize that I need to go to Nineveh. These guys need to hear the word of God, and I've been told to give the word of God to them. I'm on my way. Is there something maybe that you're trapped, that's got you trapped or in bondage to by some lack of repentance? Are you moving along in your progression of spiritual growth or maybe not moving because there's something in the way? Is there a lack of repentance in something like Jonah, right? He was stuck. He needed to have a diversion for a little while, needed an attitude readjustment. Is there something you need, I need, to get us back in a place where we're going to follow God's directives? Nineveh was waiting on God through the person of Jonah, and perhaps there's someone waiting on you. And now some thoughts. When I said the title of this was The Long Arm of the Lord, right? We saw the long arm of the Lord reached out and created a perfect storm to be used for many. The long arm of the Lord reached out to the sailors through disobedience. I'm sure Pastor Jim talked about that last week. The sailors, even though we had a disobedient Jonah, at the end, after they tossed him in, everything calmed down. They are worshiping the true God, not what they were doing in the beginning of the chapter. The long arm also reached out and directed a great fish. The long arm of the Lord reached out to a disobedient Jonah. And finally, the long arm of the Lord reached out through a now obedient Jonah to a city needing forgiveness through repentance. This will show my age. When I was doing this, and this is kind of why I came up with the title, because it popped into my head. Any of you guys remember from probably 80s, 90s, the singer, Christian singer by the name of Wayne Watson? So he was one of the guys I really liked. He did his own guitar. He did a track, and then when he came out to do his music, he played the track and he sang and played the guitar because he was very, very talented. This is a song he wrote, and it's pulled from, for lack of terms, from Psalm 139, 7, 1 through 2, in Isaiah 50, verse 2. And it says, a million dark alleys you can hide in, dig a tunnel to the center of the earth, convinced you've got nobody to confide in, got you questioning the sum of what you're worth. People label you the black sheep of the family. Come collect on your prodigal reward, because you can never outrun or go beyond the reaches of the long arm of the Lord. Huh. I've been ashamed, I've been humble and forgiven. I've been chastened by my Father's loving hand, but still at times I go on with my evil. It seems to constitute the nature of a man. But forgiveness is as close as my confession, and my sin amputated by his work. Because you can never outrun or go beyond the reaches of the long arm of the Lord. If he gave to me all that I deserve, this could be my final breath, but with compassion in his eyes, he's drawing me home into his arms, into his tender arms of rest. There are pagans at the corners of creation, making light of the salvation that we know, and with a small, narrow mind, I give them over to the passion of godless seed they sow. But in truth, we have just as much potential to be godly and perfected by the word, because you can never outrun or go beyond the reaches of the long arm of the Lord. So if you haven't heard it, it's actually a pretty good song. He's got quite a few songs, and they tend to be, you know, some things I listen to that are contemporary Christian from way back when, and now it's like, where did you get that? But you let him listen to a pretty good song. So, fellas, thank you.
Thank you.